Hello and welcome to The Reasons I'm Broke. I'm Daniel.
And I'm Kelli.
And we got a lot of announcements this week, especially on the video game side. We'll get to that after the comic books, though. We're going to start off on the indie side.
First, we have Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, The Secret History of the Foot Clan. This is number 2. We were really, really impressed with this one last month. Not just the story, but the art style that they're taking as well. This is following, like it says, the history of the Foot Clan and where they actually began, leading all the way up to Shredder. And you're also mixing in Shredder with a doctor who knows a lot about these things, a college professor. And in this issue, you see that professor gets kidnapped, and it's the Turtles trying to save him. Meanwhile, they're weaving in more of the story. Again, I was very impressed with it this month as well. Not my pick, but it was high up there.
Yeah, it was very good. Fan of Splinter or Shredder, you should definitely check out this TMNT. It is a separate miniseries from the main series, which is Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. But this one doesn't ignore that main story, which is what I really liked about it, because it kind of still goes in a timeline with what is going on in the main series. And that's, a lot of comic books don't really do that too often. They kind of try to stand on their own as a series. But the Foot Clan one, I think, is more loyal to the story than some others maybe. We also got Bart Simpson, number 79. This one, Lisa becomes a prankster. All of her anger out anytime she lost against Martin or any of the other guys in any of the contests, like the spelling bees, and she uses that anger to come up with these really creative pranks. And Lisa's already like a very smart kid as it is, so you see some cool stuff come out of it. Like Bart at one point becomes bald and looks exactly like Homer. And then the backup story, it's Bart and Lisa and Milhouse playing like the Ouija board with ghosts coming out, and they're like, well, it's not really a ghost, and they're trying to figure out exactly what's making noises around the house. And that was kind of the backup story to it.
Yeah, it was a cute issue. I don't think I liked it as much as some of the other Simpsons comics that we've picked up, but it definitely had, like you said, the one with the pranks. That was a really cute story. I think that was my favorite of the two. I know you said you liked the second one better with the ghosts, but it was a good issue. I would probably still pick it up.
Yeah, it wasn't bad. Liked it.
Next, we have the final installment of Before Watchmen, Minutemen. This is number 6 of 6. This is finishing up the story with the old Night Owl and Hooded Justice.
Yeah.
And how he thought Hooded Justice was kidnapping little children, and you see the conclusion of that. This one was actually my pick of the week. It was a strong series all the way throughout, and unlike Silk Spectre, it remained strong until the very end. I thought the ending was very well thought out, and it was very gripping, and there was no good conclusion. You were just like, oh man, this is the way it has to be, but it sucks that it has to be that way.
Yeah, out of all the Before Watchmen that have come out, I think Minutemen is the one that has the most balls out of all of them. Like, the other ones were really careful about what they wanted to change and what they wanted to introduce, but Minutemen is literally like, there's a big reveal on what some of the characters were doing right before Watchmen, with Hooded Justice in particular. Like, that's pretty much who the whole story revolves around. And the way it ends, it's kind of a bit of a shocking ending. There's a twist to it.
It lets you see the nitty-gritty of all the characters. It doesn't try to make them look out to be like these fantastic heroes. These are just regular people. This is all the shit that they did. They're really terrible, terrible people, despite all the good that they were trying to do. They're just horrible people.
Yeah, very strong series. If you're going to only pick up one of the Before Watchmen so far, I would say Minutemen. We still have to see kind of how Ozymandias plays out. But Minutemen is significantly stronger than Silk Spectre, which was my favorite up to this point.
Right. Well, Silk Spectre was good up until that last issue.
Yeah.
Minutemen, and I was waiting for that fall. I'm like, Silk Spectre did it to me, Minutemen. Don't you do it to me, too. Don't you do it. And then it was strong all the way throughout. Yep.
And part of the Death of the Family tie-in, Nightwing, number 16. Written by Kyle Higgins, drawn by Eddie Barrows. This was a very cool issue. I don't think it was as strong a tie-in as Batman and Robin, but Joker did do some pretty fucked up shit to Dick Grayson's...
Robin.
Robin. To his old circus.
Yeah, that was some crazy stuff. Again, we don't want to spoil too much as far as the series, because everything is very shocking. Maybe in a month or two we'll do a special where we talk about everything that was seen in it and our reactions. But there was a part of this book where I was like, wow, Joker. First of all, where do you find the time for this stuff? Like, really. And secondly, just to see that different aspect of Joker. I like this whole death of the family. You're right, it wasn't as strong as some of the other ones. I still thought it was a decent book.
Now, Joker did point out that he feels like Nightwing is the one that weakens Batman the most out of the rest of the Bat family. Would you agree with him in that?
Probably. Because he's just, like, whiny. He's a whiny little bitch. I did like Joker also pointed out that he took Batman for granted.
Right.
Like, Batman gave him all this. He's like, no, I'm going to do my own thing. But I would say that Nightwing's the most emotional out of all of them, and that probably weighs on Batman more, because that's one place that Batman can't go.
Is to be emotional.
So he can't relate to Nightwing. When Nightwing has these insecurities and these issues, Batman cannot connect with him the way that I think he could with the other Bat siblings, because Batman can't grasp those emotions.
Yeah. But if you are reading The Death of the Family, if you haven't read the last Batman, read Nightwing before you read Batman, because that all these events happened before Batman number 16.
Yeah. Next, also with The Death of the Family, we have Red Hood and the Outlaws number 16, written by Scott Lobdell. This was the weaker of the two that we have this week for the tie-ins, mostly because it follows Red Hood's friends. And I'm not too into it. It's got Arsenal in there and Starfire, I guess.
Yeah.
Is the other one. And they're fighting this little group of bum jokers. The bum jokers were kind of funny. But it's pretty much them just fighting these people, saying, and then the Teen Titans come in. And it's all, let's team up together and let's save these bums and let's do, and I don't care, get back to the Joker.
Yeah, it was pretty much like a Teen Titans, Red Hood, and the Outlaws issue. I don't think there was much to say in terms of like whether or not it added to Death of the Family. It was more about how these two teams could work together. So I'm sure if you're following Teen Titans or Red Hood and the Outlaws, you probably saw some value in this team up. I didn't. This is actually my pass of the week.
Yeah, I'm going to have to agree with that. I don't think that it went into the Death of the Family story. It's just kind of like, this is what's going on while the Bat family is otherwise preoccupied.
And there's also like a little two-page story on how Killer Croc isn't really that much of a monster. They try to make him into a sympathetic character.
Oh, yeah, sweet. Oh, Killer Croc helping people.
But other than that, it is definitely a pass, mm-hmm. I'd say.
Agreed.
This issue I really liked. Green Lantern number 16.
I liked it a lot as well.
It continues following Simon Baz, and he is trying to now get to the bottom of where Hal Jordan and Sinestro went and what the story behind his ring is, and he kind of figures it out in this issue. Sinestro was pretty cool in it. There's still such a distrust for him. Like, no one likes Sinestro, and Simon's like, well, we should see what Sinestro's up to and follow what he asked me to do in this ring, this message that he left in my ring. And the guy's like, no, don't listen to Sinestro, fuck him.
The flying squirrel.
Yeah.
One thing I did like about that issue is when they go to get the message from the ring, because I guess when a Green Lantern dies, it instills a message for the next Green Lantern that its ring goes to. So he pulls up this message, and you have one both from Hal and Sinestro. And in both their messages, they say, if you've received this ring, then you're like me. And I thought that was very interesting that, you know, is Simon going to portray both aspects of Hal and Sinestro? That's such a great setup. I'm so excited to see. I hope they take that as far as I want them to.
Yeah, and then we're going to see more of Simon also in the Justice League of America. So he'll be like a permanent part of the team. I don't know how the ring is going to work out, because he still has the ring from Sinestro and Hal. So if and when they do bring back Hal and Sinestro, are they going to have rings? Are they going to be different colored lanterns? Like maybe Sinestro will go back to being a yellow lantern. I don't know.
Spooky.
But he does do something pretty cool in this. The first time that a Green Lantern actually does this.
Yes.
For that, I think you can see how Simon is a valuable character to the Green Lantern Corps.
Do we want to give away spoilers for that?
Not on Green Lantern number 16. I thought it was a cool scene, so if you're reading it, check it out.
It was a cool scene. Maybe we'll talk about it later. And finally, we have Justice League number 16. I like this issue as well. It's continuing with the fight with Atlantis, and you find out this is Aquaman's brother that's actually waging war on them, the King of Atlantis. And Superman totally made me laugh because Batman's, you know, trying to be like, hey, you gotta stop attacking, and of course he gets punched out, and all hell breaks loose, and the first thing Superman says, where's Batman?
Yeah.
All worried about his man. It was mostly a filler issue for you guys following. I think it's going to lead up to something great, definitely getting up to the Trinity War.
What was really interesting about this issue, this I didn't like about it, is Aquaman has Batman by the throat. And he's like, you attack my brother now and an entire army rises out of the ocean. I know this is crazy, but the only way Orm will take my word seriously is if I show strength commanding you to leave. In Atlantean culture, and, you know, Wonder Woman interrupts and says, your brother's already killed people. And Batman, of course, says, he flooded Gotham. Families were trapped in their cars. People drowned. We gave you a chance. It was very out of character for Batman, because I think he would have kind of been like, well, we can't just get emotional and start fighting. So Batman does end up striking Aquaman's brother, and shit goes down and everyone starts getting hurt. And what's funny is Aquaman is going to go to attack Batman. He says, I thought you understood, Bruce. And Batman's like, as best I can, Arthur. But if we work together, we can. And I'm like, well, he just tried to fucking work with you earlier, like 2 pages ago, and you didn't want to. Now you want to work together? Come on.
Oh, Batman. Batman can do what he wants. You just stop this.
Like, what Batman should have done is he could have been like, all right, well, let's give it a shot. Worst that's going to happen is we're just going to end up fighting anyway.
Batman can do what he wants. He's got to let him know that drowning people in Gotham is not okay.
Well, Aquaman knows this.
It's like a little slap on the wrist. Like, no, little Timmy, you can't go drowning people.
And the backup story was more of Shazam, more Black Adam. And I like the part where he's like, oh, your costume's black. That's much cooler than mine. It was more of an action scene, I think, for that Shazam part. Like, it's only like a couple pages long. It's a little backup story. But Shazam is one of the backups that Cyborg calls at the end when the entire Justice League is pretty much
incapacitated. They get kind of put in these underwater cocoons and sitting down into the ocean.
Yeah, and if you're trying to follow Throne of Atlantis, you got to pick up Aquaman as well. I think it's going to end with the Justice League, not with Aquaman. But I still think it's going to lead up to some Trinity War shit.
Hopefully. I'm excited for the Trinity War.
Because a lot of people have already died in this. They're going to mistrust Aquaman, and then Batman's going to probably break away, want to, and then Superman and Wonder Woman. So that's probably what's going to trigger it, I think.
Superman's going to break up with Wonder Woman because he's in love with Batman, and that's why everyone fights. It all makes sense. Wonder Woman's pissed off at Batman because of Superman. Batman's pissed off at Superman because Superman's trying to get with Batman. And Superman's just like, ew, gross girls. And that's why he doesn't like Wonder Woman anymore.
Trinity War, done.
Written, done, send it out tomorrow.
Just tweet it to DC.
I should.
They'll print it. Now, speaking of Wonder Woman, we checked out the Wonder Woman trade, the second one based on the New 52. It covers issues 7 through 12. They are trying to go to Hades to pick up one of their friends that got taken away at the end of...
Right, the girl who's pregnant with Zeus's child. They're trying to protect this child because it's prophesied that he's going to be the one to take the throne of Olympus. In the last trade that we read, Hades took her, and he's like, yep, she's going to chill in hell with me now until you get me the throne that you promised me from Hera. And so it opens up with them trying to figure out how to get into hell to bring her back and essentially rescue her.
Yeah, the art is growing on me. Like, I still didn't like it as much as the first
artist. Oh, the first part was phenomenal.
But it is growing on me. It looks really clean. Mm-hmm. It's very fantasy-like. Not like Sword of Amethyst fantasy, but it's on its own. Like, it stands strong on its own. Much like Wonder Woman, I guess. And Hephaestus is introduced in this second trade.
I really liked that character.
He was awesome.
He was really cool.
They reveal that the way that the Amazonian women get their, or the way they reproduce and get kids is, what is it, 3 times in a century?
Something like that. They'll just go to a boat of men and be like, hey, let's sleep with all of you. And then they essentially kill them.
They kill all the guys. And
right.
They go back to
the Amazon Mount, or Paradise Island.
Paradise Island.
Yeah.
And they have their kids, you know. And if it's a boy, I guess originally they were discarding them and killing them.
Yeah, they were drowning them.
But Hephaestus instead says, you know, I will make weapons for you in exchange for these kids, and I will put them to work, you know, where I am. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was a really cool story tool, because Hephaestus becomes a sympathetic character when Wonder Woman suddenly decides to try to beat the shit out of him when she finds out what they did.
Yeah, she decides to free all the Amazonian men because she says, we're a warrior race and you're using them as slaves. And so she's beating the shit out of Hephaestus, and she's like, go ahead, all of you run. And they're like, no, what are you doing? He saved us when nobody else wanted us.
And we're happy here.
Yeah, we're indebted to him.
So Hephaestus is a cool character. I really like him now. they expanded more on Hades and how he isn't loved, and that is like a very important thing to him.
Yeah, he's incapable of love, and beyond that, he doesn't love himself.
Yeah.
Which is what it kind of revolves around. He tries to get Wonder Woman to marry him through, he uses one of Eros's guns. They use guns instead of arrows, and if you're shot with this, then you fall in love with the first person that you see. And so there's, you know, a wedding, all hell breaks loose, and you see Persephone, and that made me so sad because I love the story of Hades and Persephone. It's like my favorite myth ever of any culture. But it was written really well. You were on the edge of your seat the whole time, like, oh shit, what's going to happen? And in the end, you have the birth of the baby. I don't know that we... Do we want to give away more?
Not the whole thing, no.
Right. So, baby happens, more shit goes down.
Right. This is just like a quick skim through of the whole thing. There's a lot of detail in it. A lot of dialogue between the characters.
A lot of character development, I felt, as well.
Really cool trade. Wonder Woman is, like, quickly becoming one of the things that I'm mostly looking forward to. Mm-hmm. Like, this is 12 issues that we've gone through already through the trades. And I don't think there's one that was... like super weak where I would just be like, no, pass on it. It's all been very strong.
Right. As a whole, it was really strong. It all flowed well together.
If more titles end up getting canceled that we pick up, I think I would want to pick up Wonder Woman and start catching up on them.
Mm-hmm.
But in the meantime, you know, we do have such a long pull list.
Yes. That... Speaking of which, Amethyst number 4 also came out this week. We haven't read that one because we didn't have number 3. So as soon as we track down number 3, we'll read both of those and then give you an update.
And staying on, like, the comic book side, Green Lantern, the animated series.
Oh, no! Why'd you do this to me?
I don't know if any of you saw the last episode. This is the one after Sinestro. But this is the entire, like, Aya and...
Razor.
They
were in love. I cried. I literally cried, you guys. He laughed at me.
I was laughing at Razor, too, because it's like, oh, you lost someone. Oh, you lost someone again.
No, that's so sad. And then I just cried harder.
The whole time I'm wondering, where's Sinestro? Why isn't he in this? Was the voice actor sick?
No.
What's going on?
It was so sweet. And then...
Yeah, go ahead.
Aya dies saving Razor. And as she's dying in his arms, he goes, but I love you. And then she dies. And I cried. Look, I'm tearing up right now. Oh, man, this sucks. Why'd you do this to me? It was a great episode. I think it's been my favorite episode of the whole series so far. I know you don't care about the sappy love story.
I don't. I don't feel like they developed the characters enough. Or the relationship enough.
They fell in love, and that's all you need to know.
No.
Yes, they fell. So anyway, I think it's set up so that she can come back. I think she will come back.
Yeah.
And then, like, in... the end of the season, I think, is when she's going to come back. And then they can be sappy and happy and in love and have little Razor Aya babies.
She'll probably have, like, a new form or something. She probably won't be robotic anymore.
Razor Aya babies!
So, if you're not following Green Lantern, the animated series, definitely check it out. Netflix just signed a deal with Cartoon Network.
Mm-hmm.
So, they're going to start carrying a bunch of DC Nation cartoons, Young Justice, Green Lantern, the animated series. I hope they carry the DC Nation shorts also. Those are really good. Oh,
yes. We just saw that one... where it's Chinese-style Batman.
Yeah.
And it was a three-parter concerning Batman, Catwoman, and Bane. And that was amazing. That was, I think, my favorite short that they've released. I don't know if you can find it on YouTube or something. Probably on Cartoon Network they would have it. DC Nation.
Yeah, and the Amethyst cartoon has been really good, too. Mm-hmm. That's been really fun.
It's adorable with the trees in the last one.
And there haven't been any Teen Titans yet. But that's because they're gearing up to make that into a full show.
Mm-hmm. I'm excited for that, too. I love the Teen Titans.
Should be awesome. And on the video game side, the Dead Space 3 demo finally came out, along with the Metal Gear
so
Revengeance.
Spooky.
What'd you think of the demo? Like, I know you were watching me play the whole time. She's the Dead Space expert, I guess. She's been watching me play, like, both games.
Okay, I've never actually played Dead Space, but Dead Space is probably one of my favorite games. My list of favorite games goes Pokemon, Rhythm Heaven, Dead Space. Like, I don't know. Don't ask me. But I love that game. Every time he plays, I'm like, I'll be eating popcorn. I'm like, oh, he's really alive. And he's like, no, he's lying dead. No, he's alive. Go ahead. Rawr. See? He's alive. I told you. I don't think it's going to be as scary as the others. I think the first one was paced so well where everybody jumped at you the first half, and then you were waiting for them to jump at you the second half, and that made the second half that much scarier. I feel like Isaac's kind of put in a cold rest, so where is it going to go as far as that? I don't know. It's on the snow landscape in this one, and so you got guys jumping out from the ground, and that scares me. I'm like, oh no, spooky, is he jumping from the ground?
See, I've had a lot of people tell me that they can't finish Dead Space 3 or they won't play it because they found the first two, like, so frightening. They're like, oh, my heart can't take it anymore. I don't think I can play it. And it's like, I don't think any of the Dead Space games were scary at all. They're just, like, startling and jumpy, and that's it. It's different.
You don't get scared but by jump scares. Jump scares scare the hell out of me. So Dead Space is like the creepiest thing ever because they're jump scaring me the whole time. And then you're running around and then they break out of vents and they go, blah, every time. And I'm like, oh, shit.
But I'm like, I have a plasma cutter. Like, fuck that guy. I'm going to shoot him.
I'm like, but you're going to run. Well, see, you played all the Resident Evil, so you know how to conserve your ammo. I'm sitting here going, you only have 2 bullets left, and that's more than enough for you to kill him.
What do? I use 1 bullet on his arm. Cut it off, take the arm, and then throw the arm back at him.
And then stab him to the wall, and then he dies.
And then from there, take his other arm that he had left, and then use that against the next enemy. So I'm not going to use my bullets, I'm just going to use your limbs against you.
Anyway, the verdict, I would want to play it a little bit more. What we saw is things that we've seen before. We didn't get a chance to play the co-op. I would like to see how that works. I would suck, but I'll play it.
I think overall it was a little bit easier, too, than the other ones. I did die once, but it wasn't because of the monsters. It was that giant drill.
The giant drill just got me. It could be because of the demo as well.
Yeah.
I don't know if that plays a factor in it.
It could be.
But it'd be interesting. I would probably play it mostly for the story, because, oh, what's Isaac going to do now? Because that was my favorite part of the first one. You beat this whole game, and then at the very last scene, he takes off his helmet, and it's this old-ass man.
Yeah. It's kind of like Star Wars Episode 6, where Darth Vader takes off his helmet and it's like an old white guy. It was kind of like that, I guess. But then in Dead Space 2, they made him younger. It was more action-oriented. His helmet is all like Iron Man-like and mechanical.
Well, in this one, he's got like woolly snowsuits.
Yeah. So I think it's safe to say that we're kind of over that problem that we had, in which it was more action-oriented and not so much like survival horror like the first one was.
Right. This one seemed like it was more survival because you had that scene where you go in the truck and then it breaks. And I'm like, no, push buttons. You're going to die. And you're just like, whatever. Let me sip my drink before I push this button again. I'm like, no.
It's quick time events. Not scary.
Oh, see, they scare me.
And they also added like some weapon customization options. You pick up like pieces of material and metal and all kinds of stuff, different ways that you can make your weapons change. I think that's kind of cool.
I think it is. I think once you learn how to configure everything, it'll be really good for players because everyone has a different play style.
Yeah, and from what I understand, you'll be able to pay real money to get like certain materials if you don't want to wait later, which is, I don't have that much of a problem with. I probably won't spend anything on materials themselves. Mm-hmm. But it's kind of cool if you just don't want to play grind to get some of those materials, to just pay a buck or whatever to get that one weapon that you needed. It's not a big deal.
I think, assuming they've done with it what I hope they did, I think it'll be a good extra feature that they've added.
There's also new ways to customize a suit, too, which I thought was cool.
Yeah, your Mass Effect suit.
Yeah, if you have Mass Effect 3 as a save file on your system, PS3, 360, you will unlock like a Mass Effect suit, which is pretty awesome. I liked it. It was
cool. Effect suit.
Not Ass Effect.
Yes. No, not Mass Effect. Ass Effect. Okay, Ass Effect suit.
Also, Nintendo just had like their Nintendo Direct announcements, like really big stuff right before, well, not right before E3. I know there's another Nintendo Direct coming up, but it's almost like a lot of the stuff they announced this week, they're going to have at E3 playable. The big one is The Legend of Zelda Wind Waker. It's a complete remake, so it's not like an HD port. They redid the visuals on it. It's not as cel-shaded as it was on the GameCube. It's more like a 3D plasticky look to it, I think. I'm sure there's going to be some cel shading to it too, but it is different. It's cleaner, it's brighter, looks nice. They're supposedly going to have new features in it. I don't know if that means that they're going to add a couple more dungeons. From what I understand, the first Wind Waker game was rushed and unfinished, and there were supposed to be two extra dungeons near the beginning. Mm. I don't know if they'll add that, kind of be like, this is the game we really wanted to make before we were rushed to bring it out. I'm excited for it. They also announced a new Zelda that they're also working on. So people that bitch like, oh, where's the new Zelda? I don't want a remake. It's fucking coming, all right? And then all the people that are like, there hasn't been a good Zelda since Wind Waker. Well, here's fucking Wind Waker. What's ironic about it is so many people were bitching about the visuals when the GameCube version came out, and now people are bitching about the visuals in this one, in this new game. It's like, you know, which no one's ever satisfied. You're changing it, people are mad, and then they change Wind Waker, and then people get upset too.
I was most excited for Yoshi Epic Yarn. That's what it's called, Yoshi Epic Yarn. It pretty much looks like Kirby Epic Yarn, just with Yoshi.
It's the same exact makers, yeah, same developers. It's got like a crochet look to him, though, for Yoshi. Mm-hmm. I think that could be like when you're low on health, he turns into like that yarn look to it. And then when he's full on health, he probably has like that full crochet look on him.
Right. The only thing that I'm kind of sad about, it doesn't look like it's co-op, two players. That was one of the things I loved about Epic Yarn. Remember, because we used to grab each other and I'd throw you, I'd be like, nah, this is mine.
Yeah.
So I'd wait till he'd get all the way to the end of the map, almost to what he wants. And then I grab him, throw him back, and then run up and get it for myself.
Yeah.
Oh, man. So I'm hoping that there's a multiplayer aspect to it. I don't think there will be. Either way, it looks like a really fun, just relaxing game.
Yeah, that'll be really cool. They also announced a crossover between Fire Emblem and Shin Megami. So the more hardcore players, people that love either one of the series, they're going to really like this. You know, they announced something for everyone is what I really felt was successful for Nintendo's announcements. You got Fire Emblem for the hardcore crowd. You got the Zelda, which everyone likes anyway. And then the new Yoshi game for the kids.
And me.
And you. A little update on Bayonetta 2. I'm not really following that game too much, but it is a Nintendo exclusive. And I believe it's being published by Nintendo, which is...
I hope Mega 64 does another video for that.
Yeah. Yeah, make sure to check out Mega 64's first Bayonetta video if you're on YouTube watching this. Mega 64 Bayonetta. Really funny. I really enjoyed it.
Hilarious.
I'll put it as an annotation.
I think he cried the first time he watched it.
It was so funny.
Almost as much as I cried when Aya died in Razor's arms.
Yeah.
But I think that's all that we have for this week. Anything else you can think of?
No, I think that will do it. A lot of announcements. Good comics this week.
We got a whole bunch coming up next week, so that'll be a super packed.
Yeah, make sure to listen in next week. Hyrule Historia, the book. And a new Street Fighter graphic novel is coming out, among other books that are coming out. So many things that are coming.
We will be broke. Literally broke.
But that'll do it for this week. Make sure to follow us on Twitter, @ReasonsI'mBroke. Let us know what made you broke this week, #ReasonsI'mBroke. Once again, we are now on iTunes. I will update that with more episodes on February 12th because it only lets me upload a certain amount every month. But I'll eventually catch up, so make sure to subscribe on there. Just type in on iTunes, Reasons I'm Broke. If you're watching this on YouTube, make sure to subscribe. Let us know how we can improve. And thanks for listening this week. I'm Daniel.
And I'm Kelly.
See you next week.